many folks, you know, especially lay level, they might think, well, what does the text mean to you? Here, we're not looking to see how it applies to us. That is important, figuring out how it applies. But we think that there is certainly one meaning. Maybe there's two meanings, though, as well. And this is maybe where typology can get into things. Yeah, you can see where I'm going here. So maybe there's certainly a divine intent or a human intent to provide a second meaning to a text. And so this gets a little bit into the idea that maybe we could see Christ in the Old Testament. So the image we used for this week's episode was sort of two mountain peaks. Sometimes you get that analogy of you can see the first peak and there's another one over there that you can't see, but it's also that meaning. But I'll let you talk a little bit about sort of what typology is and other issues pertaining to hermeneutics. I know there's a lot for us to discuss about language, what language means, what we mean when God speaks. That's a whole, you know, another related issue. But so how is it that we need to think about these things if we want to see Christ in the Old Testament?
Well, I think the premise of typological hermeneutics is that with all the variety that you described, you have writers writing at different times. There are different kinds of literature in the Bible. And there's a lot of variety. It's a book made up of books. But the premise of typological reading is that it's a single volume. With all the diversity, it's telling a connected story, and that there's I like to use the analogy of foreshadowing. If you a novelist will foreshadow a later event or later conclusion early in the book, you don't realize this, or a detective novels are another kind of analogy where you have a skilled detective novelist who leaves clues, but you don't understand the meaning of the clue until you get to later in the book. And maybe it's not until the solution is given. You have the final drawing room scene where the detective reveals the criminal. And then you realize, oh yes, all these pieces now fit together. These things are significant in ways that I didn't realize. And I think that the Bible is written in at least an analogous fashion. There are foreshadowings of what Jesus was going to do that run all the way back to the creation, I think, all the way not just to the fall and the promise of a redeemer, but there are things going on in the first two chapters of Genesis that foreshadow what's going to happen to Jesus, and that then you can read in the light of what Jesus does and see that he's being anticipated in the Old Testament. And again, it's a way of reading the Bible as a single book. Mm-hmm. And I do want to point out something else. There's a tendency to think about typology as a kind of kind of artistic riff on the really meaty stuff of the Bible, that the Bible is historical or it's doctrinal or it has ethical import. And then in addition to that, we kind of do this artsy stuff that we call typology on top. And I think that's the wrong way to think about it. I think that typology really is, it operates at a fundamental level. And the kind of proof text of this is the way that Jesus talks about Scripture and the way he teaches his disciples about Scripture after his resurrection. We have a couple of incidents at the end of the Gospel of Luke where Jesus is teaching his disciples. He teaches the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. And it says that he starts with Moses and he talks about all the prophets. And he's basically talking about the whole of the Old Testament. And his summary of the Old Testament is that the Christ should suffer and enter into his glory, and then repentance for forgiveness of sins will be proclaimed to the nations. That's what the Old Testament is about. And so Jesus reads it as this unified thing. And it's not that Jesus is saying, you know, get your literal hermeneutics down and then you can do this extra stuff. Kind of the main thrust of the whole thing is Jesus.
Hi there. My name is Kurt Jarris. I'm an evangelical theologian, and I've come to realize that Bart Ehrman is correct.